presentation, I am a little bit uneasy because I don't belong to any of the churches, of the cults, named it before. Probably, if there is a cult I am a member of, it's the Heideggerian one. So, of course, I owe very much to René Girard in my philosophical career, but I am not going to speak about René Girard. He's here, he can speak for himself, so he doesn't need me to make this illustration of his soul. My paper has an important virtue. It is pretty short, so don't be afraid. We will terminate. We will finally finish pretty soon. Of course, if you want, we can discuss. Not only am I a member of the Heideggerian cult, so to speak, but I am Italian, and also I was a member of the European Parliament. So much of what I'm going to say conditioned by my double belonging, Italy and European Parliament, European politics, and so on. So you would not be, should not be astonished if I start by saying that from many sides it seems that nothing happens. Not even a real conversion seems to be possible in the current situation of the world religions. Is there still anybody who wants to convert from, e.g., Catholicism to Lutheranism or vice versa? I don't know, I knew just a lady theologian who converted several times from Catholicism to Baptism to Methodism and so on, and every time she made a sort of ceremony of conversion, but that's the only person I know about myself. I don't know whether I am a Catholic, I'm Orthodox Catholic, but I would never convert formally to Lutheranism. I can be a good Lutheran remaining a Catholic. This is what seems to me, and of course this is a personal opinion. Also, if a Catholic wants to convert to Buddhism or Hinduism, he does not need any special change in his beliefs and habits, just a little addition or slight modification of his view of life. The principle of dialogue excludes the very possibility of a dramatic change. That's why I start with this observation. Conversion, catastrophe, and trying to show that they don't have that dramatic meaning that we generally associate with the terms. Still 50 years ago, in Catholic countries like Italy, the fact that the great secular intellectual Curzio Malaparte, who was a writer known around the Second World War, and asked to confess and receive the Holy Communion in the moment of his death. This fact was an object of polemics, discussion, scandal. In recent years, on the contrary, and not always for purely electoral reasons, plenty of communist politicians have declared to be Catholic believers. So many of the leaders of the XXXX Communist Party, Italian Party, declare that they are good Catholic believers, they went through school as Jesuits and so on and so forth. I remember that Federico Fellini was one of those who were accompanied by a priest, in fact a cardinal, in his last moments. Fellini is a good example of a man who was never a strong believer, neither a priest eater, like we say in Italian, who mangia preti. He was a general Catholic. Consciously general Catholic. Several movies of his, especially La Dolce Vita, of course, express this sort of Italian Catholic attitude. But I would not say that the difficulty of converting belongs to the national character of Italians. Take, for instance, the relatively uniform political atmosphere of the countries of the European Union. When you say that Blair was a left-wing politician, Prodi, left-wing politician, or even Berlusconi is a right-wing politician, but we don't know exactly, because the programs, the political programs and practices of these parties are very similar. Even in the last electoral campaign in Italy, they accused each other of having copied the program of the other party. So I took that from that. No, that party. Absolutely. Absolutely. Again, it is not only in Italy that it is more and more difficult to distinguish left-wing parties and right-wing political programs and so on. The fall of the Berlin Wall was even dissolved by, even dissolved the otherness of the communist world. Putin is a good personal friend of Mr. Berlusconi. They spend vacations together. Berlusconi invites continually Putin in Sardinia. I don't know why, it's a matter of fact. Which appears to mark a different pardon. Berlusconi was always he would never make friends with a communist or an ex-communist. So he said, no, never. He insists on Putin almost every month. But what about, let's say, okay, so no great differences, but what about Al-Qaeda, for instance, you may ask? This question, of course, opens up the entire problem of Islam, which appears to mark a deeper difference, not so easily neutralizable as the other examples have made. We know that in Islam, the conversion is another to another religion is often punished with death penalty. Nevertheless, I wonder whether we might cite this as a point in a discussion on conversion. Nobody, also a serious Christian believer, would advise a Muslim to convert at the cost of his life. This, again, is something on which we have to reflect, because if we believe that it is necessary a formal conversion from Islam to Catholicism or Christianity and so on, we should ask a Muslim friend to convert at the cost of his life, because the martyrs did that at their time. In many senses, the risk of the conversion is related to the political and public aspect of it, but in no sense to the religious and salvation meaning of the act. Conversion becomes so a political act, as it is in general today, the divide between Muslims and Christians, I mean rather or exclusively a matter of belonging to a side instead than to the other. Note that this political and public meaning of the conversion is deeply rooted in the very history of European Christianity. After the individual or group conversions of the apostolic times, the conversion of entire peoples of Europe to Christianity have been determined by the conversion of their sovereign, whose conversion not necessarily was on its side a personal conversion to a faith. I don't know whether Constantine really believed in the cross, but it was useful to him to start the Constantinian period of the Church. My point is that today it is very difficult to speak of conversion in the catastrophic sense suggested by our title. Don't forget that I took the title Catastrophe, Conversion and Catastrophe, like indicating a catastrophic transformation, not simply there is a conversion, there is a catastrophe, okay. It was not simply a putting together two different terms. So, my point is that today is more and more difficult to imagine a conversion, catastrophic conversion in the sense, in the literal deep sense of the word. And this because of several factors. On one side, the increasing spiritualization of religiosity, which involves that even the priests and official representatives of a faith don't attribute any longer a great importance to the exterior signs of belonging to a church, which of course involves for the Catholics the question of the meaning of the sacraments, but I don't want to touch on this point in this moment.